good evening. Thank you very much for coming. I know the hall is so full, I have to project my voice that everybody can hear me. Is this too loud? Let me see how I lower it. Is it better?
Yes,
that's fine.
Okay, so I just lower the microphone instead of the volume. So my topic today is math and also to a certain degree statistics, although of course they are related to each other, and music, or music and math, creativity and innovation. Now I put on this initial slide here a picture. Does anybody know where it comes from? So I like this to be interactive with you. You can always ask questions too. Anybody knows where this is from?
Is this the four sciences that were studied first?
The four sciences, the quadrivium, right? It's part of the septem artis liberalis, the seven liberal arts. It is split into the trivium and the quadrivium. And the quadrivium consisted of which subjects?
Mathematics, music, astronomy, and philosophy, no?
Right, so the mathematics they called arithmetic. Arithmetic, music, geometry, and astronomy. And the interesting question now is, which one is music? Which of these four icons represents music? Any guess? Take a guess. Which one?
The bottom left.
The bottom left. Correct. And it's about the proportions. Because, and here, this is astronomy. And the first is arithmetic, and then geometry, right? Right, because it's about the proportions, and we will talk about this just a little bit, but here is the septem artis liberalis, the trivium and the quadrivium. Here's another display of all seven of them. So this is a medieval drawing from Thomas de Zecler. They're shown in pictures and also explained. So that was, of course, widely known during the Middle Ages and Renaissance. So about this presentation, I would like to give some information about creativity. I would like to talk about some inherent math and physics and music, talk about creative ways composers have used both inherent and explicit math in music compositions, and also using math and statistics to analyze music. So I want to present some of my research on expressive timing in music, which is of course math related, we will see. So let's start with creativity. What is creativity? The etymology of the term is, it comes from to create, creo, to create or make. Here's a Wikipedia definition. Some scholars, Csikszentmihalyi is probably one of the most famous one, says creativity is original, expressive, and imaginative. Here you have a more lengthy definition from the Merriam-Webster Dictionary of the English Language. So why am I talking about creativity in the context of math? Well, for sure in the context of music, everybody can understand, because we creatively create music, we creatively perform music, and sometimes we are even very creative about perceiving music or receiving music. And so I will draw some parallels later on. I wanted to start out with that. Now, if I would have had a piano here, I would have done some demonstrations on the overtone series. But basically what this is, if we play a note on any instrument, it's not just one pitch that we hear. although we think it is one pitch, and very often there are certain illusions. But let's say in the piano has a string. If we hit the key, the string was vibrating, and the string is vibrating of a number in a number of different frequencies. And this is basically displayed by this chart, and they are all in certain proportions. So if I play a very low C, then of course this C, the string is vibrating at that frequency most loudly, but it is also has the frequency of the C above it, so this is, we are an alto clef here, then a perfect fifth higher, then the next C above that, then E, G, B flat, which is a little bit lower than the B flat we tune our instruments today, and so on. This is quite important. First of all, the main point is music is all about frequencies. And it's usually a compound of different kinds of frequencies. And so with these frequencies, there are proportions between these frequencies. And we use these proportions to create our music and our scales. So now here's a chart of ancient musical intervals and the numerical relationships. And so the octave is here displayed with a proportion of 1 to 2, that's a perfect octave. The proportion of 2 to 3, that's overtone 2, to overtone 3, that's a perfect fifth, but we have a perfect fourth. We have many other intervals, many of which are a little bit different than we tune our instruments nowadays, because nowadays we like to tune our instrument in a way that we split the octave equally into 12 half steps. Now, here are some numerical proportions in antiquity. The Pythagoreans believed that the earth had four of its own parts. Water had three parts earth and one part fire. Air had three parts fire and one part earth. Fire had four parts of its own. And there are certain relationships. So already going back to antiquity, scholars and philosophers and scholars of any kind thought about certain proportions. And they related certain proportions that we found on Earth or outside of Earth, let's say proportions between planets or moons, they correlated them to the sizes of certain tones, so whole tone, semitone, and so on. But back to frequency. So the frequency actually depends on mass and tension. So for string instruments, and so everybody who's here will get a test before you walk out. So this is one of them that is on there. For strings, the frequency depends on mass, tension, and length of the string. So T being the string tension, M the string mass, and L the string length. And then this formula, which is not overly complicated, but to actually calculate that, to figure out, you know, how thick a string has to be and how long it has to be, that means how long the instrument has to be, that all goes into instrument making, right, to produce the right pitch. Now, for wind instruments, the frequency depends on the size and shape of the tube, because in wind instruments you always have a tube where the air goes through, and on the length of the air column, and the tension depends on the atmospheric air pressure and or the pressure with which the air is blown into the instrument, and whether or not one end or both ends of the tube are open. So there are some instruments where both ends are open, there are other instruments where only one end is open. So we see those kinds of mathematical relationships already with all the instruments that we have. Now, of course, music, in music we have rhythm and meter, and those are proportions too. Now, many of you probably read music, so whole notes, half notes, quarter notes, eighth notes, sixteenth notes, and each time the note value is basically half of the one before. So in one whole note we fit two half notes, four quarter notes, and so on. And then, of course, we always have music in a certain meter. Not always. In modern music, actually, we may have music not in traditional meters, but music is nevertheless structured in a certain way that we emphasize certain tones so that we get actually a feel of units that belong together. So in traditional music, we have a measure, and so 3/4 meter, for example, is a very common one, which means that the 4 stands for the quarter note. We have 3 quarter notes in one measure. Of course, we don't have to have quarter notes. We could have 2 eighth notes instead of a quarter note, and so on, but we group them together. Moreover, we emphasize certain notes in the 3/4 meter. Usually it's beat 1, then beat 2 and beat 3 are less emphasized, right? In a 4/4 meter, very often beat 1 is very strongly emphasized, then less beat 2 is less emphasized, beat 3 is a little bit emphasized, and then less emphasized beat 4, and so on. So we have another different kinds of meters here. I just wanted to give some examples. Now, a little bit more into math. The Fibonacci numbers, or also called the Fibonacci sequence, is actually named after the medieval mathematician Fibonacci, also known as Leonardo Bonacci or Leonardo of Pisa. And how the Fibonacci numbers work is that the next number is always the sum of the previous two numbers, right? Now, and you may actually find in the literature different opinions of whether we should start on 0 or on 1. But regardless, if you add 0 plus 1, you have 1. 1 plus 1 is 2. 1 plus 2 is 3, 2 plus 3 is 5, and so on. Now, if you can remember 55 and 89, because I will show them later in some music pieces, but it goes quickly, the numbers get very high, very quickly. Now, here is actually a visualization with a tiling with squares whose side lengths are successive Fibonacci numbers. So we have 1, 2, 3, 5, 8, 13. So the 13 is the sum of 5 plus 8, 21 is the sum of 13 plus 8. So how does it relate to music? Certain composers like to use certain proportions. And in this particular piece, the composer uses Fibonacci numbers 8, 13, 21, and 34. In measure 8 is the lowest tone of the piece. In measure 13 is a modulation. In measure 21, we have the highest note of the piece, which is the climax of the piece, and we have 34 total measures. How does it sound? Let's listen to this. Next example, J.S. Bach's C minor prelude has two themes with a total of 144 bars. 144 is a symbolic number, because you can you multiply 12 by 12 and you get 144. And the two themes of 89 and 55, remember those two numbers I showed earlier from the Fibonacci series, there are two themes of 89 and 55 bars each. So bar is a synonym for measures, and sometimes here I use the word measure, sometimes bars, but it really means the same. So 89 plus 55 is 144. And I don't think I have a recording of this, but I wanted to bring another example. Now, music is not the only art in which those proportions are used. They are also used in architecture. For example, the Great Mosque of Cairo is based on certain proportions. It's used in art. Leonardo's illustration of the dodecahedron is based on these kinds of proportions. It's used in design. Certain things are designed with these proportions. And of course, the proportion, if we divide one number to the by the other in the Fibonacci series, but reversed, so let's say 89, 44, we get this number. This number is very important because that's the golden section. It's called the golden section. So actually, the higher you go in the Fibonacci series, the closer we get to this magic number that we find all over in arts, in architecture, and of course in music. So in fact, we can say that the climax of this piece that I played earlier comes exactly at the golden section of this piece. Now, are all pieces like that? No. Are composers always purposefully making those, if they do put this in? I don't know in this particular case, in Chopin's case, but there are composers who purposefully put certain proportions in. There are others who do it intuitively. It just happens because that's this magical spot in the music where you may want to expect a climax, for example. Anyway, so golden section in music is often used explicitly or intuitively in musical form, sometimes in sonata form movements. For example, in the first movement of Mozart's Piano Sonata, number 1 in C major, it's 100 measures long, the exposition is 38 measures long, and the remainder is 62 measures long, which is the inverted golden section. Now, or you, if you flip these numbers, you have the exact golden section. We don't have time to listen to all of it, but I want to listen to a little bit of music here. Slides, just send me an email or give me your email address at the end of this lecture. I'd be happy to send them to you. Now, in Bartok's music for strings, percussion, and celesta, the first movement is actually 89 measures long, and the climax occurs exactly in measure 55, which is the golden section. Bach, Johann Sebastian Bach, famous Baroque composer, born in 1685, died in 1750, was very interested in mathematics and mathematical relationships. And he used theological numerology in many of his pieces. So for example, there are seven preludes in the Passion section of Bach's Orgelbüchlein. There are 27 pieces, 3 × 3 × 3, in the Klavierübung 3, a collection dedicated to the Holy Trinity. It also contains a triple fugue at the end, which is, of course, a musical music that refers to the Holy Trinity. Now, Bach uses intentionally certain numbers of measures in many of his music collections, so the pieces would relate to each other with simple ratios, such as 1:1, 1:2, 2:1, 2:3. And in fact, Bach was a member of an organization called, in the English translation, Correspondence Society of Musical Sciences, dedicated to the connections between sciences, which includes mathematics, and music. In fact, he waited to be the 14th member of that organization. Why 14? Because if you translate each letter of the alphabet, in like A is 1, B is 2, C is 3, and so on, if you translate the letters into numbers and you add Bach together, you get 14. You find 14 everywhere in his music. Even more interesting, if you add JS, the initials, Johann Sebastian Bach, JS Bach together as a number of numerology, then you get 41, which is the mirror image of 14. We also have hidden messages in his music with 59, which is Gott, the German word for God, G-O-T-T. Gloria is also 59. Jesus, Jesus in German, same word, is 70, and so on. Now here's an example, Bach's canonic variations on Vom Himmel hoch, da komme ich her, from heaven above to earth I come. The cantus firmus appears in 14 bars. Cantus firmus stands for main melody. That's that melody. Bach didn't write this. He just used it. And it's it appears here in the bass line. I will play this in a second. And if you follow this, you will hear this. And you may recognize the song. Also, 41, there are 41 bars in the first two canons together. Right? So both the number 14 and number 41 is hidden in this piece. And I will just play the beginning here. That's the cantus firmus, that's the main melody. You may recognize this. It's widely sung, of course, in Germany it's sung much more. But these proportions are in there, hidden, and they are in the formal design of the piece of music. I want to give another example, cryptography. Now, what cryptography refers to is that composers sometimes make music with letters from their name. So they translate letters of their name, or they use the musical equivalents of letters of their name. Now, as it happens, that every letter in Bach's last name is actually a node name, but you need to know that in German, what we call B, the note B, is H. What we call B is B flat. So anyways, in the German nomenclature of names of note names, B is H, right? So we have, and B is B flat. So it's really, in English, it's B flat, A, C, B, right? And so if you play that motif, you will recognize it because you have heard it many, many times. It's all over Bach's music and others who have quoted Bach. John Cage has used his name, all of his letters are note names. CPE Bach stands for Carl Philipp Emanuel Bach, that's one of Bach's sons, also a very famous composer. Now the P is not a note name, but Philipp is an F sound, so he used the F as a note name. So you have C-F-E-B-A-C-H, and you have that. Dmitri Shostakovich, Soviet composer, used D-S-C-H. S, in German note names, or in European note names, is E-flat. E-flat, S is E-flat, so we have E, and when you flat, we call it S. E-S, but it sounds like S, so they use S. There are other composers like Schönberg use S as well. Niels Gade, Béla Bartók, Arnold Schönberg, they all use, here is an example by Schönberg's Kleine Klavierstücke, Opus 19, number 1 in measure 5, where you see his name. So we have S, C, H, B, E, and G. Okay. Another example: Mozart, musikalisches Würfelspiel, or musical dice game. So actually, Mozart was not the first, and surely not the last, who developed a dice game. And what they did was, there was a certain repertory of measures that, and these measures Mozart composed. And the idea was, so now there is a certain repertoire of measures, and you roll the dice, and whichever number you get, that's the number of measure you take. Now, in certain parts of the piece, you have to take a different repertoire of measures. So you have a nice beginning, middle portion, you have a nice cadence at the end, and so on. But the idea was that even somebody who doesn't know much about music, they may be able to play, but let's say somebody who doesn't compose could compose with this musical dice game. It was very, very popular in Western Europe in the 18th century. So Mozart actually wrote the most famous of those games, and you could write waltzes that many. I don't even know what number that is, 11 to the power of 16. So here's one example that is composed with Mozart's dice game. This is Dmitri Nikolaevich Smirnov, pieces for piano from Cycle Ciphers, and he used the letters translated into Morse code and made a rhythm out of it. So he uses basically tone durations for, translates the Morse code into tone durations. There are other examples with rhythm and meter. Metric modulation is one of them, also called tempo modulation. You change the pulse rate and or pulse grouping. And there are a few examples. I like to always demonstrate this one. Let's say you're in a piece of music where you are in a duple meter and you go into triplets, and then you switch to the regular eighth notes being as long as the triplets used to be. So, like, I should go further away from my microphone. And then I'm metrically modulated to a different feel. It provides a different feel and a different tempo in this particular case. There are other transformations possible, permutations, so we can transpose, inverse, retrograde inversion of pieces. There are prolations are possible, that means augmentations or diminutions, so we can make tone durations longer or we can make them shorter. We can do that with intervals also. We can make intervals larger or make intervals shorter. There are others that I don't have time to discuss: multiplication, rotation, transformation of intervals, spectrum, or timbre. There are many, many possibilities that composers have used for centuries. Here is an example, by Bach, of a piece called the Crab Canon. Now, crabs walk backwards, right? So this piece you can play forward, you can play backwards, and it still sounds good. Haydn wrote a piece like that too, by the way, which is a very different kind of style, musical style. It's quite interesting how it even works. But here in this piece, so you can play it forward, you can play it backwards. Not only that, you can also play it backwards and forwards at the same time, and it sounds good. And it can be visualized with a Möbius strip. A Möbius strip, I wanted to bring a piece of paper, and I forgot. But if you have, let's say it's a little longer. Normally it's much longer. But if you put it together, then it looks like this, and it has two edges, right? But if you actually flip one side, you will see that better in the video. If you flip one side and put it together, then it suddenly only has one edge. It's called a Möbius strip. You will see this better in this visualization. And I didn't make this, I just found it on YouTube. And so here it is. Yesterday when I tried it. I'm very sorry, but if you take a mental note of Crab Canon, Johann Sebastian Bach, and you put that in the search bar, and maybe Möbius strip also, and you put this in the search bar in YouTube, you will actually find it. There are other examples I could talk about, such as 12-tone music, but time is limited. I need to move on. So set theory is another one. I want to show you briefly a website that I developed. Actually, a friend of mine who used to teach at Texas State, Paolo Cesani, was at that time writing a book that related to music of Béla Bartók. And the final book title ended up being something like Transformations, Tonality and Transformation in Modern Music. So he dealt with symmetry, for example, because Béla Bartók sometimes used pitch sets or scales that are symmetrical, such as, well, whole tone scale is symmetrical, but Béla Bartók sometimes used it has a minor third scale and so on. And anyways, or other symmetrical, say the octatonic scale, He actually used octatonic scale quite often, and other composers did too. And so my colleague asked me, can you develop a website, because I was in have been doing computer-assisted music analysis. So he said, can you develop a program or website where I can input a set of pitches and it tells me if they're symmetrical. And so he actually bugged me for a number of years, and eventually I did. And I teamed up with Luc Pierre-Pinard and developed this website. And so, for example, if we, so this was the fastest here to copy and paste something. If we type in a number of pitches, and then it tells us whether this set of pitches is symmetrical or not. In this case, it is symmetrical, and it shows us the axis of symmetry. And the axis of symmetry happened to be halfway between E and F in this particular case. A pitch that doesn't exist, but it could be a pitch that does exist. So if we type in, for example, C, D, E, F sharp, or even G sharp, that of course is the beginning of a whole tone scale, and it is symmetrical, and E is part of the pitch set, and is also the axis of symmetry in this particular case. Now, then he also wanted me, because sometimes we analyze music, we have a piece of music where we don't know what type of scale a composer used in the 20th century especially, but sometimes in the late 19th century also. And so I developed this program where we can type in any kind of set and hit submit, and it tells us what types of scales this could be, and if we know it must be based on cycles, everything can be based on cycles, but this example is not so good. If we know it is, let's say, a piece of modern music, then in this particular case, there is no scale. Anyways, this program has more than 1,000 different scales in it. This set, for example, C, D, D sharp, E, is a scale that sometimes referred to as Shostakovich scale, and it can be found. And there are other program options where you can say match the input order or allow rotations, and or only consider consecutive notes. Anyway, so basically, it's not very creative in terms of the program itself. It simply calculates what kind of properties a certain pitch set or group of pitches has. To move on, digital storage, music storage, and compression. Now, as you know, I mean, back when I was a child, when I was a young child, we didn't have any CDs, and everything was not digital. It was analog, so it was on tapes. And then CDs came up, and of course computers came up, and we needed to store music digitally. And so they realized that if you want to have a very high definition, a high resolution of the sound, then it is very, very, will have very, very large files, extremely large files. So they came up with different kind of compressed formats. And those compressed formats, they leave out some information. But when we listen to it, it still sounds good. Now, if we listen to an MP3 file under headphones, we realize it doesn't sound as good as an WAV file or AIFF file. Because an MP3 file is very compressed, it leaves out some information. And all of those are based on certain algorithms. Not only that, there are other math in music. So CDs came along, and when you would scratch on the CDs, and you would put it back in the CD player, you could still hear the music. unless it was really, really badly scratched, then you couldn't hear the music anymore. But if it was a little bit scratched, you could still hear it. So you could assume maybe it wasn't damaged, maybe it's scratch resistant or so. No, but that's not the case. They actually were damaged, physically damaged. So they developed, scholars developed algorithms for error correcting. That means, and so this is actually an algorithm that goes back to the, was developed, I think, in 1960, and then was later used in CDs. It's called the cross-interleaved Reed-Solomon coding. So they have some, they put in some pieces of information that is not needed for the music, that is only to check whether certain parts of the CD are damaged or not. And the CD player would read those, and if they were damaged, it would automatically correct it. It's very deep math that, in fact, I must confess, I don't even understand. Now, you can also think of pitch distributions in tonal music. So if you have a tonal piece of music, like Bach, here's a C major prelude from Well-Tempered Clavier, then it is in C major. Now the C major scale is C, D, E, F, G, A, B, C, but there are other pitches in there. There are C sharps in there, D sharps, F sharps, G sharps, A sharps, and so on. And so there is, we can look at certain pitch distributions. Why are they in there? Because there are also secondary dominants for the musicians here. There are secondary dominants, or there may be modulations in some pieces. That means it goes to a different key temporarily and then comes back to the original key. But even if it stays within one key, there are other pitches in there because there are other chords that contain either chromatic alterations or they tonicize diatonic chords, and so that's why you end up with other pitches as well. And now we can study that, and we can create these histograms. That means how frequent are certain pitches, and that can tell us about the time period, because in Bach's time, that pitch distribution was different than during the classical period, and it was different again during the Romantic period, where they used much more of those tonicizations or modulations, so it's much more evened out during the Romantic period. But not only that, scholars can also now analyze music digitally with computers based on the score, and they use the pitch distribution to determine the key, for example. Now, we as a listener can, if we are a trained musician at least, we can relatively easily recognize what key we are in, or at least we can sing, even if we don't have perfect pitch, we can identify where the tonic is, and then we can go to an instrument and see what pitch this is, and we know which key we are in. For a computer to do that, it's quite difficult. But there are ways to do this, and one way is to use these kinds of pitch distributions. Now, I have dealt with computer-assisted music analysis for many years. In fact, going back to the very late 1980s, and I initially wrote a computer program that I started initially alone, and then collaborated later with a physicist who was much better in programming. Using a number of statistical and information theoretical measurements. And really what we wanted to do is, we wanted to find style characteristics. So let's say there was a Bach piece and a Mozart piece, and we wanted to see how statistically are they different. But even more interestingly, let's say there was a piece there where we didn't know who the composer was. There are many of such pieces where we don't know who the composer, or we don't know for sure if Mozart composed it or not, and we can do comparative analyses. And we can, of course, we can do this manually too, but there are statistical and information theoretical ways to do this, and these are all the formulas that we use in my program, and these are the measurements. And I don't want to go into detail, but this program was exhibited at the International Computer Exhibition in 1996. the Zeebent in Germany was the foremost, the leading computer exhibition in the world. And 2 years later, this program was totally outdated. And that's how it is. And at some point, we decided not to maintain this program anymore. But we did also histograms like this with regard to pitch or with regard to tone durations and so on, or three-dimensional displays related to pitch and tone duration. But I want to come to a much more interesting topic, coming back to creativity. So when we can actually ask, can we make a computer compose? But before I get there, I want to do something totally different, which is play a piece of music. And I want you to guess who the composer is. Okay, at this point you can start throwing out names of composer names if you like.
Classical style.
Classical style, very good.
Haydn
or Mozart? Anything else?
Stamets.
Could be a little bit of Stamets, which is early classical, or what we sometimes call pre-classical music. Very good. Wrong. It was David Cope, who lives on the West Coast somewhere. No, it's not wrong. It was actually absolutely correct. So what David Cope wanted to do is he wanted to write a computer program with which he can analyze music. And for this music that I just played to you, he actually fed in all of Mozart's symphonies. They were all Mozart. And the program analyzed it and basically calculated some statistical and other statistical information theoretical measurements, and then used those characteristics to compose a new piece. He has done this with many different composers. Now, if you listen actually very careful, it doesn't sound right on some parts of it, right? A composer, musician, say, not the head. Sometimes it didn't sound quite right, and it is not perfect. It's not a real Mozart or a real Haydn, and so on. But it comes pretty close, and for, let's say, an untrained musician, it could just as well be a Haydn, right? But the interesting thing is that we can program the computer using math and statistics, these measurements, to derive information from the music that then can be used to recreate the music. And if we do that, we can actually learn about the music. And that's what I do when I do research. I want to learn about music and also teach it to others. Now, creativity and expression. I know we are halfway through this lecture. That was a joke. I'm not supposed to be over by 7, so I only have 10 minutes left, but I wanted to show you a little bit of my research on expressive timing in music. And I will actually skip forward to a different piece of music that I did. That is a study on rubato that I did. Now, rubato is actually the freedom in performance. Let's say we have quarter notes, but we may also clap them like, which is not quite regular, if you notice, right? I tried very hard to make the regular at the beginning, and then I was a little bit irregular. So when we actually perform music, we perform music creatively. And what that means is we actually, we perform it expressively. We may prolong certain notes where we want to slow down or speed up at other times, just to make it more emotional. And that is just part of normal performance. And there is a bunch of people have done research on that, but I don't need to summarize that. So this project involved four recordings of an invention number nine by J.S. Bach. And I will play all four of them, just the beginnings. Here's Glenn Gould. So all of these pianists, they are very famous. You may recognize some, if not all, of the names. Glenn Gould. Question was, how can we capture the freedom in the performance? That means the degree of rubato in which the performers perform the durations of this piece. And I chose this piece because this piece almost entirely has a 16th note everywhere coming in, a new 16th note coming in until the second to last measure until here. But there is a 16th note. So what I could do is, I could use a computer program where I do an onset detection. And onset means whenever a new note comes in, that's an onset. And this piece has an onset on every 16th until the second to last measure. And so I could take just all the 16th and I could add them together and divide them by the number of 16th notes, and then I have the average. And I have the average 16th note. But furthermore, I could calculate a measurement called a standard deviation. So there's a formula. It's not overly complicated, but basically that standard deviation calculates the average deviation from the average tone duration in this particular case. And that standard deviation would be a measurement for the degree of rubato. And then I also wanted to ask listeners on how they perceived the music, because I wanted to see, okay, I can calculate the standard deviation, I can say that's the degree of rubato, but how do we actually perceive it? Do we perceive it just like I calculated it from the performances, or do we perceive it differently? So I did a scale from 0 to 10. Now, it's not the usual Likert scale that you see. The more normal Likert scales are more like 1 to 5 or sometimes 1 to 10. I wanted one from 0 to 10 because that could correlate to the standard deviation, which is usually captured between 0 and 1, or you can multiply it by 100, then it's or by 10, then it's from 1 to 10, right? So, and I ask undergraduate students to listen to all four pieces and to rate them. 0 being the strictest performance, 10 being the extremely free performance. So, what did I find? These black bars are the calculated standard deviations, and I wrote them here in terms of percentage. So I multiplied it by 100, so 12%, this is 26%, this is 14%, so this is gold, Rübsam, Bacchetti, 14%, and Blatter, Ingold Blatter, the very mechanical one, 3%, right? And the length of this bar visualizes that percentage of the standard deviation. So now, how they are more to the top or to the bottom of this? This is the average 16th inter-onset duration. That's in seconds. Of course, if the tempo is slower, it's higher up here, and the blue dot is the average for each piece. If it's lower, then the tempo is higher. But what is important is the length of this bar or this number. And then these are the perceptions, but they are what I call scale perceptions, because actually for that second piece that I played, the Rübsam piece that had very much rubato, a lot of freedom in it, some of the students, or many, marked a 10, the most, the freest kind of performances. And if we are in performance, I mean, if I come from my German piano teacher who said it has to be strict, and I would hear Wolfram Rübsam, I would say that's a 10, right? And some students named a 10. Other students weren't quite a 10, but it turned out, so I scaled it, I made it comparable to the standard deviation, and what I found is that actually our perception, at least the perception of those students, correlated with the calculated standard deviation, which means that we can use the standard deviation, which is a statistical measurement, the standard deviation reflects the degree of freedom in the performance. And so now we could look at many more performances, and I'm working on that, and we can say, okay, on average, most performers perform it in a certain way, right? And that can maybe, but we could also ask other questions when we play it to people. We could ask, now you don't rate the degree of performance, right? Degree of freedom right now. You tell me whether you like it or not on a scale from 1 to 10, or whether or something like that. So whether you like it, right? And I could tell you, I would have said, I don't like Rübsam. On how that is performed, because it was too free for me. Anyways, so we could also ask other questions, and I know I'm now out of time officially, so I'll take just 2 more minutes over, if you can. This is one measure, just to see the metric positioning of these 16th notes within one measure. I could also take the durations of just all the very first 16th in each measure and calculate the average, and the second 16th in all the measures in the piece of music and average them, because I wanted to see, are there certain parts of the measure longer or not? And I actually assumed that the first note would be longer because the motif in this particular piece starts on at the beginning of a measure and it recurs in this piece, and whenever the motif comes, the performer slows down and makes that first note a little longer. But not only that, although the note immediately before the motive is slowed down. So the performers actually slow down before the main motive comes to communicate to us listeners that, okay, here the motive comes, listen up. I'm slowing down, listen up. The first note then is longer, and then it goes on with a regular tempo and relatively evenly. But there are certain performances more expressive and others less, and then I could also do this for the entire piece, calculating the four different performances, and here Rübsam is the green bar that always goes the highest. And it's interesting to look at, so it's basically math that I use to analyze these performances, and that then tells us about the creative aspect of the music, the creativity put in by the performer to change durations, to communicate to us on how we are supposed to hear that particular performance. And with that, I would like to thank you for coming out tonight. And I just wanted to give you different examples of the relationship between math and music and what has been done in the past and what one can do. And I appreciate you coming out and thank you for attention. Thank you. And if you like, you can ask questions or you can ask me questions. Yeah, sure.
Do you have a sample of the most called composition?
I couldn't find that, the Morse code compositions, but unfortunately, it would be nice to listen to that, right? Very good. Anyways, if you have questions, feel free to come up to me and